So the first thing we're going to do is an activity called String Around the World. So you may have seen this before. If you know the answer, don't tell your neighbor you know the answer, because everyone's going to answer themselves, and then we're going to look at it. So some of you have probably done it before. I know some of you have done it before. So let me open the activity up. And everyone in Presidio, Dr. Kep's going to pull it up for you. And you guys can answer in your group, and then we'll pull together to see what the numbers were. But if you're watching at home as well, you can answer this question yourself and then see the answer when we discuss it. So I'm going to pull it up here. Or not. I guess I downloaded the wrong one. Just give me a minute. I'm going to pause the recording. Okay, so this is the question. If you're watching at home, imagine that you tied a string around the center of the earth along the equator. The string lies on top of the ground in the ocean, so just on the top of the oceans. And you untied the string and added 6 more meters to the string, pulled the string away from the earth all sides equally. What is the largest animal that could walk normally underneath the string? So, your answers are ant, mouse, cat, goat, or horse. So, if you're watching at home, pick your answer. And here we're going to stand in the different corners. So if you think it's ants, come over here by the projector screen. If you think it's mouse, come over here. If you think it's cat, I guess come over by this band. If you think it's goat, go back to that corner. If you think it's horse, go over by the projector that's against the wall over here. So everyone move to their answer. So I'm going to pause the recording again, and the people in Presidio, you can do your answers as well. We'll give you about 2 minutes to get into your places for answers. We're going to write our numbers down on this end. Okay, so we have the ant. We had how many people?
8.
Mouse, we had
3.
Cat, we had 1. Goat, we had
1.
And horse, we had
5.
All right, what about in Presidio? What were your answers? So we had on our end, we had 8 voted for ants, 3 for mouse, 1 for cat, 1 for goat, 5 for horse.
Okay, we got 1 for horse.
Wait.
2 for goat.
1 for mouse.
1 for mouse. And
1 for ant.
And 1 for ant.
1 for ant.
All right. So everyone go back to your seats and we'll talk about this.
11.
So I want you to, in your groups, try and do the math to calculate it. If you're in a table with one person, you can join together with another person. There's only one table with one, so at least two people at a table. Do the math that you think it would take to show the right answer, right? So I'll give you 5 minutes to do the math. 5 minutes to do the math. I'm going to pause the recording. If you're watching at home, do the math yourself and see what your answer is now. Okay, so instead of going around to the corners of the room again, I'll just have you raise your hand, so maybe you changed your answer. So this is the first trial, right? Okay, so how many people are still with hands? Raise your hand. People are still with hands. Three? Raise your hand. Three of you with hands. How many people are with mouse now? Raise your hand if you're with mouse.
I didn't do anything to change my answer, because I don't know.
You don't remember what your answer
was? Well, my answer was mouse, so, but I don't know, so I'll stay with that.
Okay. How many people are with cat? Raise your hand. Still one. How many people are with goat? Raise your hand. Goats. Three. So we added two. And how many people were with horse? I guess the rest of the people were with horse. How many people is that? I guess I could count back.
We just say it. I think
I'll go down. It was mouse? How many people with horse? Raise your hand. One, two, three, four. Four. So we have undecided voters. We have hanging cat in the room. What about Presidio? Did anyone change your answers?
Well, we got a small group here. At this point, we're all pretty much saying that we think the biggest animal you could put under is a goat. Oh, Mr. Z, no. We have one sticking with a horse, and one's before, and I'll throw my voice in there, five. We have a small group, and I like being considered a human, too, so. So add five to goat.
All right.
We weren't in the second time.
Change the horse?
Okay.
So what math did you do to figure this out? So you're looking at the circumference of the earth as the length of the string, right? And you added an x. And solve for the radius. Okay, so what is the formula for circumference? This is the circumference, right? So we'll say r is the radius of the earth. We could actually figure it out if we wanted. Okay. What are you talking about when you're talking about walking underneath the string? You're talking about
the what? The radius, right? So you want to know the increase in the radius, and you know the increase in the circumference, right? So the relationship between the circumference, so I'll say, we'll call that C, and the radius is, that the circumference is 2 pi times r. So what is r, if you call for r?
So
r equals 3 over 2 pi, right? So what are we adding to the circumference? So we have some new radius is related to the circumference plus 6 meters over 2 pi, right? How is this different from the original? Well, if you do some fraction, what's the change? Well, what's c over 2 pi? That's what? The original radius. So the only change in the radius, which is what you're going to walk underneath, right, is what? 6 over 2 pi or 3 over 5, which is about what? 95 meters, which is how many feet? Approximately 3 feet. So if you add 6 meters to the circumference of the string and pull it out equally, you're going to pull it out about 3 feet everywhere. Which animal to walk under that approximately? A goat, right? A horse is generally taller than 3 feet. A goat should be able to walk under about 3 feet. Cat is, you could argue that you had a tall goat, maybe, I don't know. The answer is goat.
Short horse,
yeah. Pony. So I like this question because it shows you the relationship between the radius and the circumference. Even though your circumference is huge, adding 6 meters to the circumference still adds about a meter to the radius, regardless of how big the circumference and the radius were to start with. It has no relationship on how much is added, right? So if you had a golf ball and a string around the golf ball and you added 6 meters to the circumference of that string and pull it out everywhere, it's still going to be about a meter away from the golf ball. Regardless of how big or small the object is, that has no bearing on the change or the relationship between the radius and the circumference when you're talking about the chain. I like this question because I guess ants, right? Because that makes sense. You think it's going to move out so small because you're only adding 6 meters. You're talking about the whole earth. When I first did this a couple years ago, that's what I guess. Right, you don't have to convert to C. All right. So the next thing we're going to do is another 3-act video. Now, I found another place that has more 3-act videos and lessons outside of the Dan Myers one, and I found a couple that I like. The first one's a golf one, which I like golf, so I'm going to do a golf 3-act video first. So we're going to pull it up on our end. I'm going to turn off the sound so that for Sidio, you guys can watch the video, the first act, and then we'll come back. So I'll give you about 3 or 4 minutes to load up and watch that video. I'm going to turn off the sound. Well, first I'm going to find it so that the online people can get the link. So let's if you're watching at home, if you just Google 3x math problem 4, I guess, 3x math problem. This is the website. What we're going to watch is 4 right. Okay, so if you're watching at home, this is the place that you need to watch this video. Okay. Now I'm going to pause the recording again so we can watch it on our end. Okay, and Yvonne, if you want to click on that link down on the in the chat bar, you can go to the video we just watched. Okay, so the first thing that it asks is make a guess just from the information you have how far you think he is away. So I'll pull up the numbers again here. Let me pull up with the information that you have. I'll pause the video.
Yeah, so I can see what the hole is. Like the yardage.
There you go. So this is, can you see that?
I can see it from the very beginning of the model.
This is the end, right? So the ball is here, the hole is here, and you have 3 distances out on the fairway. Because you know where the sand trucks are at. So the first is a guess. So write down a guess of how far you think that blue dot where the ball is into the red dot, which is where the hole is at. And every measurement's in yards.
Okay.
Golf measures in yards. So this is 95 yards to the hole.
Okay.
136 yards to the hole. 36 yards to the hole. Okay. So write down a guess. To me, this looks like the British Open, but I'm not sure. Okay, what's your guess? You need some guesses. 117 yards. 105 yards.
I said 61, I don't know why.
1 yard. Any other? What?
97
yards. Sounds like someone guessed. We have 150 yards from Presidio. 128 yards. Anyone have a different number? Sounds like Presidio all said 120 and 135 yards. So we have so far guesses anywhere between 61 and 135 yards. If you play golf at all, it's a lot of different clubs. We have a punch shot here all the way up to maybe for them like a pitch wedge. Yards. So all of you with that, you would all be saying different clubs to use.
Oh, no, 36 yards in the hole. Oh,
not from that show.
Okay, so what information
do you think you need?
You need a third word.
No, not what club you need. What information do you need? So you need an angle? Well, what did the announcer say they were using? So what's that? Now you're clear we need the right triangle, right? So let's look back at the this is the first picture, right? So let's move to the next picture. So here's another picture. Okay. So do you need more information? Maybe if you look back at this picture, okay. So with this information and this information, make another guess. The first two pictures, make another guess. So these first two pictures, make another guess. I'll give you one more minute to make another guess. Hey, right, what's some guesses now? Did it change? How many people think that it's closest out of those four numbers to 128?
Closer to 128.
Who said 128? You should raise your hand, right? So if you think that it's closest out of those four numbers to 128, raise your hands. Then Presidio said 115, 117, and 100, okay? We have 115, so I'll say there's two here and one here from Presidio. How many people? Yeah, 117. 115 is the closest to 117. And no, 105 instead of 100, okay. So
How many people think that out of those four numbers is closest to 128? Whoever said 128 better raise their hand. How many people said that multiple? How many people think it's closest to 105?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
Okay, we have 10 there. How many people think it's closest to 100?
2.
And 117.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
All right. So, maybe with a little more information, what if you have this information? And it's kind of deceiving on this screen because if you look on the actual screen, this one stretches out. So this isn't a right angle. So it is. On this ginormous wide screen, it stretches it out. So it looks less like a right angle. It is. If you look on a regular size screen, it actually looks like a right angle.
Oh, yeah. It looks like.
It looks like. I didn't say it is. It looks like. But it doesn't. It kind of looks like it here, but it kind of stretches out the picture a little. Does that make sense?
All right. I'll give you one more minute if you want to calculate your answer.
No.
The next one
we had is a course test.
The next time.
Yeah.
Okay.
So give me some guesses.
101, 128.
Any other guesses?
Yvonne says 102.
Okay, so how many people think it's closest out of, I'm going to group 102 and 101 together. So how many people think it's closest to 128? The people that said 128, better raise your hand. I didn't say you. Someone just said 128. You guys didn't say 128.
We were talking
about it.
So everyone guesses 101 to 102, somewhere.
Can we put 115?
Yeah.
How many people think it's close to 115? Three people.
and the rest.
I think it's in between, so you start in the first time.
And three for 105 and two for 102 on in Presidio.
Okay.
Okay, so we're going to watch the third act of the video, which has the actual numbers in it. So I'm going to put up, so Yvonne, you can look at it in the same place. I'm going to turn off the sound on our end so Presidio can watch theirs and pause the recording. So if you're at home, you go to the same place, you look at this video, right? So let's... So what assumption did they make in the video? They made the assumption that it's a right triangle, right? So if it's not a right angle...
And all the geometry teachers are going to argue with it.
Yeah. And all the geometry teachers are going to argue with you, okay. Which is okay. So if it's not a right angle, so someone mentioned if it was a 100 degree angle, how far was it?
20.
So if this was a 100 degree angle, can you say it was 128?
That's a good
time. So what did you use to log those numbers?
So it was like 95.
So... the sequel, I guess, what they say. Draw a different triangle where the shot length is the hypotenuse. So the length of the shot from the ball to the hole is the hypotenuse. What are some of the possible dimensions? So go back to here. I guess to here. Draw a triangle where the shot length, a right triangle, the closest you can, where the shot length is the hypotenuse.
Try and manage the volume. I apologize when it gets way too loud. Oh.
Sorry if it's loud.
No, I forgot I had my talkie thing on. At the end, when you come to the conclusion, we have two things we want to share with you, but go ahead and continue what you're doing.
Okay, we're going to finish up in a couple minutes. We're just going to do that last question. So draw another triangle where the shot length is the hypotenuse and calculate the shot length that way. So I guess I'm going to draw... So what triangle, the best you could draw from the information you have, what triangle would you connect?
95.
That's assuming it's the right triangle, right? You can't call something hypotenuse if you don't have a right triangle. So the question says draw the right triangle back, you need to make it hypotenuse. Okay. So what information would you need here? You need five. If you're trying to calculate this, then you need the point here, right? So what does it seem like it is? If you look at the picture, if you kind of measure distances, it kind of seems like the same, right?
Yeah.
From the hole to the first sand trap, from the ball to the second sand trap,
seems reasonably close. So if you use that,
what would you get as the length?
What would you get as the length from the ball to the hole?
You're making these big assumptions, right?
101 yards again. Okay. It should be longer than 95
for the side button. And you got what?
103.
So the announcers didn't say what right triangle they made, right? So I guess, Presidio, what did you want to share with us?
Oh, let me see if I can figure out how I am. I set up as a moderator.
Oh no, let me
add
that.
So. Okay.
You're a moderator now. Now you're
okay,
a moderator.
Okay, so I'm going to share out. I'm going to share out my desktop. And so one of the things that. You know, I'm teaching geometry right now, and one of the things we'll spend some time on in the Summer Institute significantly is going to be GeoGebra. And so putting the picture in GeoGebra, and this is just a really rough sketch, it allows you to do what you might do if you were doing it with a compass on a piece of paper by drawing concentric circles. And that lines up those distances all in relation to the hole along one line, and you can see that the ball is more than 95 yards away, but quite a bit less than 136. And who went up there to the front and did? Taro went up to the front and just sort of estimated the distance of that green circle that marks the ball. How many copies of the distance from the 95 sand trap to that circle you could get going out to the 136? And so he was thinking that that probably justified an estimate of around 105 or so. And so it's just kind of a way of approaching it with technology. The other thing is a cautionary tale. I noticed you all didn't get what we got when you got to the end of the video. You got something like, what was the title of the advertised video at the end of your Act 3? A Fighting Chance. You had an inspirational title video that was being advertised. Well, we didn't get that. We got a video called Lonely and Horny from Jake and Amir,
Warren, we realize this is recording, we're going to post this, right?
Yeah. Well, this is an important cautionary tale, because with high school kids, you've then lost them for quite a while when that title pops up.
Right.
And
yeah.
So, something at putting on your teacher hats, if you click the download here, and you may have to go to Dropbox and a few other things, it's not hard to do. I last night downloaded the zip files for all this and was able to download the video, which I elected not to use today. And I'm kind of glad, because now we've seen something that can go wrong. I've now got the Act 3 video on here, and I can preview it ahead of time. I don't believe the downloaded video comes up with an ad. But it certainly wouldn't come up with something that would basically send my class into spastic fits for, you know, probably the rest of the period.
Right, and that's good advice, so I'm glad you shared that. You're right. So you could, if you're showing in your classroom, you could download them ahead of time and only have the video, not the website with the advertisement on it.
And a handy tool to know about, Firefox has an add-on called Video Download Helper and a few others that allow you to pull videos off of YouTube, basically to make your own duplicate. sites like YouTube are monetized and they pop up advertisements that sometimes you have no predictability on that, and it can really cause problems. You know, that story of what happened in your math class is going to get back to your principal before the end of the day. And that could be embarrassing, especially in some of our rural districts.
I agree. So thank you for sharing that with us.
I will give you back over control, or you can wrest control from my hands or whatever.
All right. So, and that is a good lesson. So you can download them ahead of time, even onto your computer in your classroom, so that you're not pulling up a website that has advertisements, which can apparently be pretty shady. Right? I guess we got fortunate, or however you want to call it. Because when I played it, we got a fighting chance.
That's what I got seen on my iPad when I went to the...
I don't know what that is, but... Well, like Dr. Keck said, these websites make money off of views on videos, so what pops up here can be pretty random. This is Vimeo, is what it is. It's not YouTube. All right. So that is a good lesson, though. So the next thing we're going to look at is we're going to continue on with our fostering algebraic thinking material. So let's open it up here. So we are going to watch my recording. Let me see. Yes. We're going to watch that video again one last time, but this time we're not going to watch the in-class part. We're going to watch the post-interview, and you're going to think about some questions, and we're going to discuss in a group about the post-interview. So last time you watched the video that Dr. Kep was nice enough to digitize from a VHS for us. So we're going to watch the post-lesson interview this time and think about what the teacher has talked about. Right? So I'm going to and I emailed this out to everybody, I believe, didn't I? The link. So I guess Yvonne, if you can go back into an email I sent out last, like a month ago or something, I can try and send that again. But should have had a link to the video we're going to watch, because I can't really play it for you. So we're going to pause. I'm going to pause the recording, pause the talk. So turn off the sound. So if you are at home, pull back up the email I sent you, which has the video of the lesson. It's the last half of that video that we're going to watch right now. So I'm going to pull it up for the people watching at home. So we watched that video I sent out the link to. So think about this at home, these discussion questions. I'm going to show them slowly. If you don't have, Yvonne, if you didn't have the video, then you can answer the last questions. You know, when you work with your students, what kind of balance you look for between questions that relate to your goals and plans for activities and questions in response to things that happen in the moment. And then the last couple of questions you could actually answer without having the video that we watched. So if you're at home, answer these questions. And if you're watching at home, you need to email me some responses
throughout this video to the things that we were doing, like your guesses on the golf problem, so that I know you're watching the video, so that it will count as your attendance, basically. Or Yvonne, you're logged in, so that's your attendance. So I'm going to scroll through again. We'll give you 15 minutes to answer these questions.
I'm going to go ahead and
Okay, I'm going to stop the recording. So if you're watching at home, we had some discussion. If you're watching this at home, type up a couple of questions or some answers to this that you have, and you can email them with your email that you send me as part of the attendance. Presidio, do you have anything you want to share, or? Well, I see you're typing something now.
Well, we had a pretty rich discussion about it, and I think we're about ready to move on.
Okay, well then we'll move on to the next activity, which is the postage stamp activity. Okay. So I'm going to pull it up here for those watching at home, and then I'm going to pass it out. Okay, so this is more postage stamps. We already did a little bit of postage stamps, right? Like I said before, this is a very classic problem that can be used from elementary up to graduate school. The first on brief, but they actually get to be approving something to take this on the top, right? So. So if you're watching this at home, the postage stamp problem, work in your groups. So if you're at home, do this by yourself, but work in your groups to come up with an answer, and I will give you, say, 25 minutes. So I'm going to scroll through this if you're watching at home, so you can see all of the questions. That's it. So go back through it again. Okay, so I'm going to pause the recording. So if you're watching at home, answer the question. I've given this us about 25 minutes, so you can take that long yourself. And then when I start again, we'll start discussing our answers. Okay, so Presidio is going to discuss on their own. So I'm going to talk to this group here. If you're watching at home, once again, the problem was here, so let's look at the beginning. So the first problem, which amount of postage is it impossible to make with 6 and 9 cent stamps? Which ones are impossible?
Well, obviously below 6.
Anything below 6?
7 through 8.
7 through 8. And then anything that's not above 0.3.
Right.
And then on multiple of 3. Anyone get a different answer? Let me make sure I'm recording. Yes, okay. So, you can't make anything below 6, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You can't make 7 and 8, and then you can't make anything past 9 that's not multiple 3. So the question then on the second part is, explain how you can be sure that they're impossible. How would you explain that it's impossible to not, you can't make any number that's not a multiple of 3 past 9 cents. How would you explain that? Well, so what do you do?
I said X was the number of six that you can't subtract. And Y is the number of 1 cent. So the total amount that posted
would be 6x plus 9y. And you can factor 3 out of that. Take that whole bunch of 3y. And no matter what your x and y are, you can always multiply by 3. So this is a way to show algebraically that it is impossible to make a postage that's not a multiple of 3, because any postage made with 6 and 9 cent stamps has 3 as a fact, right? So you can explain with words. Someone in the back explained it that both numbers have a factor of 3. So any postage has to have 3 as a fact. This is a little more algebraic or number theory way to think about it. So what about, so did anyone have a different answer for that? Or anything else they want to discuss? Yeah, so then problem 3 is, how do you know those are the only impossible amounts? How do you know you can make any multiple of 3 past 9 with this postage? So we've already established we can't make it unless it's a multiple of 3. But how do you know you can make any multiple of 3 past 9? So, or I guess past 3 even, right? So the only multiple, we've said now that the only multiple of 3 we can't make is 3. So we should be able to make 6 cent, 9 cent, 12 cent, 15 cent, 18 cent, 21 cent, 24 cent. How can you be sure? Start plugging in numbers forever or?
Yeah,
the green common factor of 6 and 9 is 3. And so you already start with 6, and so 9 is just adding another 3.
So the GCD of 6 and 9 is 3?
Yes. Yeah.
I would use a number theory just like this.
Right.
So. Okay, so we said that this is 3. So you're saying that that's the only thing you have to worry about.
So if I gave you a
multiple of 3, say 99, how do you make it?
With 6 and 9.
7 and 9. Times 11. Okay, what about 102?
11.
What about?
We have to make it with 9.
We have to make it with 9. And then
2. So, how did you do that? You took away a 9 and added 2 sixes, right? So what's happening here? So what if I said, how do you make 105? So what did you do there?
You took 1 6 away and added a 9, right?
So what really happens here is that 3 can be written by what you did in 2 different ways. How?
3 times 3.
Well, with 6 and 9 times 10.
No,
3 squared times 11.
Is that what you're saying? Or?
No, just using 6 and 9. So 9 minus 6, so minus 1 plus 1. What's another way? Where this is negative.
-2.
That's what we just established, right? It's that I can add 3. As long as I have a 6 cents stamp to remove, I can add a 9, take that away and add a 9 cents stamp. Or if I have a 9 cents stamp to remove, I can take it away and add 2 6-cent stamps. So you can just keep using this rule to add 3. As long as you have at least 1 6 or 1 9 cent stamp to remove. Well, as long as you have a multiple of 3 that's past 3, you're going to have a 6 or a 9, right? At least 1 6 or 1 9. So that's okay. This would be a way you would start establishing this with, say, number theory. So did anyone have any other insight on this? Problem 3. So what's another way you can think about this? If you look at 6x plus 9y as 3 times 2x plus 3y, and you focus on just the 2 and the 3, you can establish as well that 1 is 2 times something plus 3 times something, and 1 is 2 times something plus 3 times something, where one of them is negative and the other one is negative. What would that be? Right, so as long as you have 1, 2, or 1, 3, if you factor a 3 out, as long as in the rest you have a 1 or a 1 3 or 1 2, you can add 1, which is essentially adding 3, right? Because it's actually 3 up. The same way to look at that with simplifying away the 3 in some sense. So basically you're saying with 2 and 3 cents stamps you can make any postage you want past 1. Because it's for 2, 2 times 1 for 3, it's remove the 2, add a 3. For 4, it's remove the 3 and add 2 twos. For 5, it's remove a 2 and add a 3. For 6, it's remove a 3 and add 2 2s. Or you could remove a 2 and add a 3. That one has 2 ways to be written, right? So this is how you're going to build it. And this would be an induction argument if you wanted to do the proof.
All right. What about problem 4? So 4 goes back to what we did the first time, right? 5 and 7 cents stands. So how would you answer question 1 with 5 and 7 cents stands? Which, remember question 1, if you're watching at home, we're looking at question 4. Question 1 is, which amounts of postage is impossible to make using only 6 and 9 cents stamps? So how would you answer question 1 if you replace the 6 and the 9 with the 5 and the 7? So which postages are impossible to make with 5 and 7 cents stamps? So, did anyone look back and get an answer, or?
We did some.
What's the answer?
1 to 4.
What's the largest? So, okay. 23 is the largest you cannot make, right? All right, so there was several before 23, but after 23, we established last time that we could make any postage. Why? So you could always, so the GCD of 5 and 7 is what?
1.
So you should be able to write one thing and another thing, because you should be able to write the GCD as a linear combination of the two numbers. You should be able to write 1 as 5 times something plus 7 times something. And 1 as 5 times something and 7 times something. What are those somethings?
4 and 3
is 1. So this one will be 4 and this 3. Okay. 7 times 3 is 21, minus 5 times 4 is 20, that's 1, right? What's the other one? So the negative is on 7. Three. 5 times 3 is 15, minus 7 times 2 is 14, that's 1, right? So you can write 1 as a linear combination of 5 and 3 in two different ways, where one of them has 7 with a negative and one of them has 5 with a negative. So you can use this rule then to make values. So you start with 20. 20 is what? 5 times 4, right? 7 times 0. So 21, well, we remove 5 4s because 1 is take away 5 4s, put in 3 7s. So we take away 5 4s, put in 3 7s, right? 22 is, well, you take away 2 7s and add 3 5s. Right? I'm sorry, 2 7s. But 23, can we follow this? Well, we're supposed to be able to either take away 4 5s or 2 7s. Do we have 4 5s or 2 7s? No, so we can't do it. Right? So we're stuck there. So hopefully, maybe that's ringing a bell for the last question that I just wrote down. So problem 5 says do some exploration, basically. But problem 6, find out a rule that explains how you can tell for any pair of stamps whether this largest impossible amount exists. So what rule did you come up with to say, if this is satisfied, then a largest amount exists? Largest impossible amount
The largest value that you cannot make with the same. So if what's true about the two stamps, then there is a largest impossible amount. So first of all, with 6 and 9 cent stamps, was there a largest impossible amount? No. Anything that's not a multiple of 3 is impossible. There's an infinite number of those. There's no largest number that's not a multiple of 3. So there's no largest impossible amount. For 5 and 7, was there a largest impossible amount? What was it? 23. So what criteria do you need to place on the two stamps for there to be guaranteed a largest impossible amount?
The greatest common factor is 1.
Seems like a reasonable assumption. So let's say if you have A cent and B cent stamps and the greatest common divisor of A and B is 1, then a largest impossible amount exists.
But if the two stamps are 1 cent and 2 cents,
then the largest impossible amount is 0.
So we're still finding the largest possible amount. So if it's 2 cents and 3 cents, the largest possible amount is 1.
Yes.
Okay.
And if it's 5 and 7, the largest impossible amount is 23.
Yeah, I was thinking of that backwards.
Oh, you thought largest possible? So you can't.
I'm thinking largest impossible amount, and I'm thinking with 1 and 2, there's not an impossible amount, because 0 would be the largest possible.
I mean, you could make 0. You can't make minus 1. You can't make minus 1. That makes it impossible. You could say minus. Can establish that, or you could say they have to be bigger than 1 if you don't like that, because you have to be careful on those kind of wordings.
Okay, so does everyone agree that if the greatest common divisor of the two stamps is 1, then you have a largest impossible amount? What is the largest impossible amount? You have A cents and B cents. And A, B is 1. Well, you don't really have enough information for that, but if you do some number theory, you can establish that there are positive integers, big fold numbers, W, X, Y, and Z, such that AX minus BY equals 1 and BW minus AB equals 1.
Which negative one?
So yeah, I'm excluding the value. No, it still works, right? Like if you do 1 and 2, then if A is 1 and B is 2, then X would be 3 and Y would be 1. Those are positives.
So if you have this, what do you think would be the largest impossible amount? Now look back to what we had for 5 and 7, right? We had 5 times 3 minus 7 times 2 equals 1. And we had 7 times 3 minus 5 times 4 equals 1. What was the largest impossible amount?
23.
What was the number before that? How did you write that?
5 times 3 plus 7 plus 1.
How is that related to our two values of 1?
Because
How many fives are here taken away?
4 5.
And so what's the next biggest integer before 4?
3.
How many sevens are taken away here? What's the next biggest integer below 2? So what do you think the rule could be? Well, here you're taking away Y V cent stamps. Here you're taking away Z A cent stamps. So what do you think the largest and possible amount would be?
B is
B minus 1. Right.
A is B minus 1.
A is B minus 1, right?
And Y minus
1. B, Y minus 1. And then anything else? But if you think about it, the Z is like the 4 over there, right?
Right.
So Z minus 1 is like the 3. The Y is like the 2 over there, so Y minus 1 is like the 1. What next? That would be like the 22. Was the 22 impossible? What was impossible?
23.
There you go. That's the largest impossible amount. Because anything past that will have enough either A cents or B cents stamps to give up to add 1, right? That's the largest number that you can make that is impossible. That's kind of more graduate level math there. Not a long time ago. Okay, so like I said, though, this problem is very concrete. You can write numbers down, elementary students can work on it. They won't get to this point, obviously, but you can work on this problem all the way through graduate school, really. It's a very concrete problem that has a very, you know, proof-based final solution, right? But you can think about how numbers are put together. It's really a branch of number theory. So let's look at the discussion. I'm going to pass out a discussion. We'll discuss this. We had questions for a couple of minutes. So think about the question.
Okay, so if you're watching at home, we're looking at these questions. So,
did everyone in your group come up with the same solution or partial solution to the problem? So, did any group have different solutions within their group? Or did everyone in your group agree with each other? Is there any disagreement? So, what strategies did you or other members of your group use to work on this problem? And how did you use the different algebraic thinking habits, right? Building rules to represent functions, doing undoing, or abstracting from computation?
Anyone want to share? So, did anyone... Did anyone use building rules to represent functions?
Yes, no, maybe.
Did anyone use the algebraic habits of mind building rules to represent functions?
Yes.
You guys did? So what function did you make?
One function.
So I know last time we did like graphs and things like that when we did the 5 and 7, so maybe someone did use a function. What function did you guys come up with? All right, so you represented the possible postages as 6 times the number, so a variable, when I wrote down the 6 times x plus 9 times y, but whatever variables you chose, right, equals to something. And so you could make a function out of that, right? It would be a 3-variable function, so I guess if you're going to graph it, it would be 3-dimensional.
Yeah.
So you tried to use a linear function, 3x plus 3, something like that.
So you did the plus 3, I guess, because you wanted to go past 3.
Did anyone use doing undoing? The algebraic habit of mind doing undoing.
Well, that's kind of not starting to take the numbers you take out all the time.
The 5 and 7? Okay. On the 5 and 7.
Okay.
So doing and doing is where you're given, you have to work backwards basically, right? So you could have done that here. You could have, when I gave you a number, like 99 and told you to make the stamps, that's undoing, right? Because you're given the answer and you have to come up with the solution rather than plugging in a solution and getting an answer.
What about the
which one can I do? So you came up with a rule, maybe like 6x plus 9y. And then you undid it by giving yourself the answer and trying to figure out the x and the y, right? That's undoing, basically. What about abstracting from computation? I guess I did the abstracting from computation, right? So maybe everyone here stuck with the computation. I don't know.
But
I know some people at least wrote 6x plus 9y. That's abstracting from computation, right? So you're taking the computation, realizing you have to have number times 6 plus a number times 9. That's an abstraction already, right? That's algebraic abstraction. Okay, did your work on the first time we did postage stamps affect your solution or the way you attack the problem?
Yeah.
You already had some experience with this, right? Wasn't the same, but the experience hopefully made you think about the problem in maybe a different way than you would have if you'd never seen a postage stamp.
I think you already knew where you were.
Yeah, right.
They can actually come up with
a plan. So you knew an idea to start, and then you had to figure out how to attack this new problem with the previous ideas, right? The last question. Like a paragraph here. So, teachers sometimes have the students revisit a problem one or more times throughout the school year. This gives the students an opportunity to explore new aspects of the mathematics in the problem. It also gives both
the student and the teacher an opportunity to notice how the student's mathematical thinking has evolved over time. So if you use what you previously did to attack this problem, your thinking has changed, right? Because it's not the same as if I had just given you this problem the first time. You've already thought about this kind of problem. Revisiting the post-exam problem after working through a number of toolkit sessions gives you the same sort of opportunity to reflect on the evolution of your own approaches to problems like this one, as well as your perspective on algebraic thinking. So, do you think you attacked this problem differently from the first time you were given a postage stamp problem? So, basically that's scaffolding on your learning, right? So you're using your previous experience. And that's our goal with our students, right, is to try and get them to take the things that we're teaching them and apply them to new situations in a different way than they would have before you taught them anything, right? Hopefully a better way. Okay, at least different. Hopefully they attack a new problem that's similar in a different way than if they've never seen anything like it before. That's one of the goals. Developing algebraic habits of mind or algebraic thinking in your students. Okay. So let's see how much time do we have before lunch? 20 minutes? Okay. So we can do, Warren, we're done with the postage stamp problem. I'm going to show them the last problem before lunch. And we'll do it kind of quickly so we finish by 12. I guess we'll try and finish by like 11:55 or something. So if you want to show the Presidio people this problem too, you're welcome to. I'm going to pull it up. It's the sneaking up the line problem. So I think that was here. Did I not? Oh, there it is. Make it up for us. So if you're watching at home, this is the problem that we're going to look at right now. So I'm going to pass out a handout to our group.
It's about Eric the Sheep. And this is for several things for the rest of the day. We're going to do some more three-act problems. I just want to do a bunch of problems today. I think that's fun. This is from your algebraic, your book that I passed out to the end of the session by the beginning of the year, last December. So you can actually look it up on your book. It's on page 35 of that blue
sponsoring algebraic thinking book. So think about this in your group. For those people watching at home, I'm going to show you an extra book.
Same problem, page 35 of your book.
I just assumed not everyone would bring that book, so I made copies.
Right. So if you're watching at home, work on this problem. I'm going to slowly zoom in and slowly go through it so you can see everything. If you need to pause the recording, pause it at any time. So I'm going to pause the recording if you're watching at home.